The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Please rise and sing hymn 579. His sake forgives you all your sins. As a called and ordained servant of Christ, and by his authority, I therefore forgive you all your sins in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Our appointed psalm for today is Psalm 4. We shall all speak it responsibly, whole verse by whole verse. Psalm 4. Answer me when I call, O God, of my righteousness. You have given me relief when I was in distress. Be gracious to me and hear my prayer.
O man, how long shall my honor be in temptation shame? How long will you love vain words and see my eyes?
But know that the Lord has set apart the godly for himself. The Lord hears when I call to him. Put your trust in the Lord.
There are many who say, who is your trust in the Lord? Lift up the light in your face upon us, O Lord.
You have put more joy in my heart than they have when their grain and wine abound.
In peace I will go by my hands to sleep, for you are the Lord, and may not the world be saved. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and will be forever. Amen.
Sunday in Lent is from Jeremiah chapter 26. When Jeremiah had finished speaking all that the Lord had commanded him to speak to all the people, then the priests and the prophets and all the people laid hold of him, saying, "You shall die. Why have you prophesied in the name of the Lord, saying, 'This house shall be like Shiloh, and this city shall be desolate without inhabitant'?" And all the people gathered around Jeremiah in the house of the Lord. When the officials of Judah heard these things, they came up from the king's house to the house of the Lord and took their seat in the entry of the new gate of the house of the Lord. Then the priest and the prophets said to the officials and to all the people, "This man deserves the sentence of death because he has prophesied against the city, as you have heard with your own ears." Then Jeremiah spoke to all the officials and all the people, saying, "The Lord sent me to prophesy against this house and this city all the words you have heard. Now Therefore, mend your ways and your deeds, and obey the voice of the Lord your God, and the Lord will relent of the disaster that he has pronounced against you. But as for me, behold, I am in your hands. Do with me as seems good and right to you. Only know for certain that if you put me to death, you will bring innocent blood upon yourselves and upon this city and its inhabitants. For in truth, the Lord sent me to you to speak all these words in your ears. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
O come, let us fix our eyes on Jesus, the founder and perfecter of our faith, who for the joy that was set before him endured the cross, despising the shame, and is seated at the right hand of the throne of God. The epistle comes from St. Paul's letter to the Philippians, chapter 3 and 4. Brothers, join in imitating and keep your eyes on those who walk according to the example you have in us. For many of whom I have often told you, and now tell you even with tears, walk as enemies of the cross of Christ. Their end is destruction. Their God is their belly, and their glory in their shame, with mind set on earthly things. But our citizenship is in heaven, and from it we await a Savior, the Lord Jesus Christ, who will transform our lowly body to be like his glorious body, by the power that enables him even to subject all things to himself. Therefore, my brothers, whom I love and long for, my joy and crown, stand firm thus in the Lord, my beloved. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
grace, peace, and mercy from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. The Psalms are an integral part of our Sunday Divine Service. Many of you read at least one psalm a day, which means that you read the church's first hymn book at least twice every year. Now, the psalms are classified into hymns of praise, of laments, thanksgiving, of confidence, remembrance, wisdom, and finally, also, some psalms are called the messianic psalms. Now, our psalm for today, Psalm 4, which is what our text is based on for the sermon, can be seen as a combination of two genres. It is a psalm of individual lament, but it is also a psalm of confidence. In fact, it moves from one to the other, from distress to quiet confidence in God. One commentator explains that Psalm 4, it is not a psalm of penitence, arising out of a recognition of sins committed. There are other psalms for that purpose. It is rather a psalm which reflects the anguish of the innocent and the oppressed, or of the righteous sufferer. And thus it is particularly an important kind of psalm, for it addresses a fundamental human experience, the experience of injustice, suffering, and oppression. Now, however, while there is injustice we all experience, there is more to it than meets the eye. If we step away for a moment from this edifice we have created, an edifice which is built on our self-righteousness, our good works, our oh-so-just dealings with our neighbors. As soon as we step away from it, this self-absorbed, self-glorifying structure, and look at it from God's holy standards, you will arrive at that question, is there such a thing as a totally righteous sufferer? Is anyone ever really innocent? The answer is, of course, not. Unless, of course, you're thinking of the Lord Jesus Christ. Now, St. Augustine got it right when he says that Jesus is the cantor of the Psalms. He's the one who is singing the Psalms. But that is not really the point here. None of us is ever innocent, utterly innocent. But there are nevertheless times of relative innocence in which evil people really do heap injustices on us. There are times when we are falsely accused, and other times we are slandered. Someone may want to advance himself by getting us out of the way. Or an attack may be occasioned by pure envy, jealousy. About four centuries before Christ in Athens, there lived a man called Aristides. The Just was his title. He was one of the most outstanding statesmen that Athens had produced. However, the Athenians practiced the system of checks and balances, and the system was called ostracism. That's where our word ostracized comes from. But this system of ostracism, which gave the right to all citizens to nominate a person who they thought threatened their democracy. It was to be a system of checks and balances, to curtail the one from overshadowing all others, and thus threatening the egalitarian principles of their city democracy. And so the anecdote about Aristides goes like this. A man walked up to the city gates, and not knowing it was Aristides himself who posed the question, so Aristides asked him, "Which name shall I write?" The countryman replied, "Aristides." "Very well," remarked Aristides, as he proceeded to inscribe his own name. But he says, "Tell me, why do you want to ostracize Aristides? What has he done to you?" The man replied, "Oh, nothing. I don't even know him." So on he sputtered, "I'm just sick and tired of everybody calling him the Just." And so Aristides, a brilliant statesman, is exiled for 10 years. Perhaps you have experienced something like that. And all here can narrate how the experience landed, unprovoked spitefulness at one time or another. All have had their reputations attacked, although the attacks on you probably have not been accompanied by an actual physical danger. They have nevertheless probably hurt you a lot. When we were children and our friends and playmates said nasty things about us, we were taught to say this, right? I hope you remember, sticks and stones can break my bones, but names will never hurt me. But it was not true, as we probably found out. Names do hurt. To be falsely accused is agony, and we have to rise above it. However, not all of us have the ability to rise above it. Often we are caught from all sides by tribulation that we have to bear. And so the psalm asks the question, how long shall my honor be turned into shame? And how much shame, tribulation, do we have to bear? A lot of you might wonder if tribulation is really a good thing. Now we all remember that there is a cross we carry in life, but in this cross of Christ we glory, in it alone we can make sense of the trials in our sojourning. In fact, it is good for the faithful soul, most church fathers say, that the faithful soul must be tested and confirmed by temptation in this age. Lententide is that yearly reminder of the 40 days of our Lord's fasting. We are following after our Savior, who chose to contend with the devil in the desert in Matthew 4, in order that he could secure our salvation and be the faithful champion of our struggles. Jesus descended into hell, and later he ascended into heaven. So also, the soul descends into temptations of hell to ascend to the glory of heaven. And so, as the man goes, so temptation and tribulation come. And yet these things should not be considered a hindrance to the Christian, rather a testing fire which purifies our faith. Dr. Luther, in his exposition of Psalm 4, he talks about this threefold enlargement or growth which God provides in tribulation. He says that the first is that of education. The second is that of strength. For, St. Paul writes, strength is made perfect in weakness. A bent palm tree springs up more strongly, and strength pressed down and grows larger. Thus, love, faith, hope, and all others grow larger in persecution. According to the word, their beginning has been strengthened without measure. The third enlargement of growth is that of comfort and joy in the Holy Spirit. And so the Apostle St. Paul says, blessed be God, and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of mercies, the God of all comfort, who comforts us in all affliction. And so we are made resilient by the entrance of the Holy Spirit, who is also called the Paraclete, or the Comforter. And herein lies the beauty of this psalm. It is a psalm of individual lament, yes, but it is also moving from the lament into confidence. In our trials, we receive, as it were, a practical education that one learns that God saves us from distress and aids our soul to grow in confidence towards God. For only in turmoil there is growth and enlargement. Just as the mind is enlarged through education and understanding, the memory or the substance of the nature of the soul is enlarged through the strength and vigor of grace, and the will is enlarged through comfort and joy. On the contrary, all these are diminished by sin and error and sadness. Now, Isaiah the prophet in 54:2, he exhorts the nations, he says, enlarge the place of your tent, and let the curtains of your habitations be stretched out. Similarly, in an allegorical sense, the church receives a threefold enlargement. For they were exceedingly multiplied by the Pharaoh's oppression, it is written about the children of Israel. And the truth of the faith was made illustrious, and their joy in the Spirit was increased, for they were now going to worship their Lord in the wilderness. There is remarkable grace in God, and he does not cause these enlargements to be repayment and reward in this life. But he says, for me, for my good, for my salvation, for my benefit. Now there is a flip side to this. God indeed enlarges and exalts many to their destruction, to their ruin and judgment. But this is not the case with who are enlarged in tribulation. These have received their tribulation, all manner of wrong, rejections, sustained slander, as something that the Lord has given them. They know that God wants them to receive an education, for strength to grow in the comfort and the joy of the Holy Spirit. When the gusts of wind and waves of the water raged and scared those in the boat with Christ, the little faith was real. When the Israelites went out to conquer the Midianites, they were first tested by water. So those who are going to enter the heavenly fatherland, victorious over enemies, are tested. You see, the fire purges. Christ, the physician, employs many bitter seeds that choke the pestilence and thorns of self-love and worldly desires. So our Lord sends tribulation that excites the scrutiny of the conscience and the sins of the past. Finally, trials and temptation illuminate us to the fragile and vain consolation of the world. And when we have been left with no recourse in this world, the cross and the crucified one are illuminated in our souls. For only in trials and temptations we become attuned to the cross that is laid upon us. These must be gladly welcomed by all who are grateful for Christ, the one who bore our infirmities, who gladly suffered crucifixion in our stead. But now, because of his crucifixion, he gives us the fruits, his body and his blood. The heavenly manna is here. The rock of all ages is now for us to eat and to drink, to nourish us in the church's suffering now and in the times to come. For all called Christians are bearers of this legacy of the name they received first in Antioch. And the Psalter impresses us to be educated, to be learned in God the Father, who sent his Son, to be strengthened by his Son, come in these sacred elements, and by our eating and drinking, so receive the comfort and joy multiplied to you by the Holy Ghost. In Jesus' holy name, amen. Let us pray. O good Jesus, scorch me here, persecute me here, so that you may spare me in the future. Let whatever adversity, tribulations, and want I suffer educate me, strengthen me, and having been purged by them, so receive comfort in distress and joy through the Holy Spirit, who reigns with you and the Father, one God, world without end. Pray for all people in Christ Jesus and for all people according to their needs. Heavenly Father, see how many still walk as enemies of the cross of Christ and face destruction. Make known your mercies in Christ that we may repent and become citizens of your kingdom. Protect your people from their evil intentions and grant that we would follow the example of the apostles who willingly suffered wrong to make Jesus known. Lord, in your mercy, remember the households of this congregation, O Lord. Provide help and companionship to those who live alone, and foster love between husbands and wives, parents and children, that our homes would not be places to worship our bellies, glory in shame, or set our minds on earthly, but a refuge here and a foretaste of our heavenly home. Lord, in your mercy, remember our nation and those who have been placed in authority above us. Give them wisdom and integrity. Grant that neither they nor the citizens of our land would hinder your church or despise your call to repentance. We also ask for peace throughout the world, especially at the conflict in Ukraine and Russia. Be with the leaders and grant them wisdom to desist from their war and to follow the path of peace. Lord, in your mercy, remember the sick and afflicted, O Lord. Especially do we remember Colin, Linda, Patrick, Rosie, Jordan and Jose, Jim, Ford, Ivan and Nora, Julia, Nathan, Robert and Helen, Marilyn and family, Elfie, Ashwika, Adam, Liz, Herb, Judy, Pastor Joseph Devon, Annie, Renata, Les, Lynn, Joanne and Bruce, Emma, Katana, Renata, Jack and Shirley, Mitch, Pastor James, Luke, Richard, Beth's mother, Lee and Aunt Alice, Sonia, Luke, David, Gail, Carl, Rose, Dawn, and all those we name now in the silence of our hearts. Deliver them for the sake of Christ, who cast out demons and performed cures on his way to finish his course at the cross. Strengthen their faith to hold fast to him, who rose again to raise them also. Lord, in your mercy, remember this household of faith, O Lord, and gather us together at your altar as a hen gathers a brood under her wings. Unite us in true confession of your word, sincere repentance for our sins, and joyful confidence in your Son's body and blood for our forgiveness. Lord, in your mercy, Holy God, we deserve nothing but judgment and disaster for our sins. Open our eyes so that we do not take your wrath lightly, but strive by your grace to mend our ways and our deeds. Lord, in your mercy, Almighty God, your Son suffered the reproach of mankind, even as he bore all of our sins to the cross. Strengthen us gladly to bear reproach in your name, and to boldly declare your salvation. Through the same Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, world without end. Amen.
Thank you. the king the assaults of the devil, and give his blood as a ransom for many, that with cleansed hearts we might be prepared joyfully to celebrate the Paschal feast in sincerity and truth. Therefore, with angels and archangels, and with all the company of heaven, we Lord and magnify your glorious name, ever praising you and singing.
The Lord be with you all.
We give thanks to you, Almighty God, that you have refreshed us through this salutary gift. And we implore you that of your mercy, you would strengthen us through the same in faith toward you and in fervent love toward one another. For Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.